She was a street fighter. I mean, this girl could lay it down, and she terrified me. And I remember she was waiting for me after school. Hi everybody, I'm Kim Jagway of God's Perfect Size. Welcome back to video 5. This video is brought to you by God's Perfect Size and our Freedom Food Series, and it's entitled Abide. I'm so excited to share this video with you. If you've never thought of abiding as a weapon to use against the devil, then you are going to be blown away. So make sure you stay tuned to the end of this video because I'm going to share about the weapon of abiding. Are you ready? Let's do this. So as you know, I'm not a doctor, a psychologist, or a psychiatrist, or any of the ists and the ologists. I'm just a girl who sought the Lord for her weight loss. I was caught in food addiction for years of my life, for actually decades of my life, and God gave me a way to fight back and fight my way out of it. And now I'm teaching you how to do the same. So if you're struggling in that area, or that sounds like something that you might need, then let's dive into the Word of God and take your freedom back. So as we always do, I want to begin with a bit of prayer because I know that God is able to deliver us. I know that it's by His power and His strength, and it's the truth of His word that will deliver us from any snare and any trap that the enemy has placed us in. So let's seek the only one who can do something about this. Let's take it to the throne. Father, we thank you for our time together. We invite you into this space. We invite you into our hearts. God, we pray that you would touch the places that need touched, that you would just bring us a word of truth and knowledge, a word so powerful that it can do nothing but transform our lives and set us free. Father, we pray that your word would rattle the enemy and shake the chains off of our lives and make us walk in freedom to do your will. This is our prayer. We invite you in. Holy Spirit, speak to us and give us a message personal to us. Give us exactly what we need to hear. We commit it all to you, Father. In Jesus' name, amen. If you agreed with that, then go ahead and say amen. So the backdrop for our teaching today comes from John 15, 5 through 8. If you've never read John 15, 5 through 8, then go ahead, grab your Bible, grab some tea, pause the video, grab what you need. Let's read through this together and let's get an understanding of what God is saying to us here. So John 15, 5 through 8. I am the vine and you are the branches. If you remain in me and I in you, you will bear much fruit. Apart from me, you can do nothing. And if you do not remain in me, you're like a branch that is thrown into the fire and withers. Such branches are picked up and thrown into the fire and burned. But if you remain in me and my word remains in you, ask, listen y'all, ask whatever you wish and it will be done for you. This is to my Father's glory, that you may bear much fruit, showing yourselves to be my disciples. Now, number one, I'm not even gonna spend a lot of time on this because I feel like we all understand what this means. Can we just go asking for Lamborghinis and whatever we want? I mean, you can give it a try. You can see what the Father will do. But really, this asking is about the Lord's glory because he even ends it in verse 8. This is to my Father's glory that you bear much fruit, showing yourselves to be my disciples. Whatever you ask for is going to be representing Jesus. Whatever you ask for in the Father's name has to glorify God. So I feel like if we get nothing else, then just know that when you're asking God for something, it's for his glory and it's to show your discipleship. That's what a true ask really means. So it's not about accumulating a bunch of stuff. God is not some little God that we can put in a bottle and make into our personal genie. We know that's not how this works, but I'm excited because what we know to be true is that this God that we serve is a God of freedom. He is the God who sets us free. He comes for the captives. He comes for us who are trapped by the enemy. And so we can ask freely for those things because God gets the glory. When we eat to glorify God, the bodies that we're in are used for his glory, then he says yes and amen to all of those things. So let's talk a little bit about what it means to abide and how is it a weapon. So I entitled this series Abiding because that's just a very biblical word. It's very scriptural. But let's break it down a little bit. What does it mean to abide? Let's take some of the Christianese out of this because we like to say, oh, I abide in the Lord. But the truth is, abiding is really just a close relationship. Abiding is so much more than hanging out. Abiding has to do with intimacy, has to do with closeness, has to do with relationship. And this is what it means to abide. It's not some big, theological thing that we have to understand. abiding is kind of like what you do with a family, with your mom and dad. These are the people who know you best and who love you the most. These are the people who would come for you if they lost you. These are the people who will fight for you and advise you, not because they want to manipulate you, but because they love you. That's what abiding is. It really is just being in an intimate, close relationship with God. It's the same thing with your spouse. It's the same thing with your parents. It's the same thing with your children. So you're abiding with these people that you love. Well, God wants that to be our relationship with Him. He wants us to be in His presence. He wants us to sit at His feet. He wants us close and intimate, all up in His space. He wants to feel your breath at His feet. Like, He wants you that close. That's what it means to abide. You know, I was thinking a lot about abiding this week, of course, because it's our topic, but I'm closest to my family, and I thought a lot about my mom. And you know, I love her dearly, and I talk about her here on this channel a lot because she's one of my greatest role models. So my mom, she loves certain foods, and onions being one of those foods. So when I'm with my mom and I make her a dish, I know I'm gonna load it with onions because I know what she likes, and I wanna give her things that she enjoys that are good for her. Also, you know, when we go for Christmas at her house, my kids always say when they come back, my clothes or my jacket smells like grandma's house, because not only does my mom love onions and eating onions and cooking with onions so that fragrance is in the air, but she loves some bleach. I'm telling you, if you go to my mama's house, especially during a pandemic, you might get sprayed with a little bit of bleach because she gonna kill them germs on you. But when we go to her house, we come home with those scents clinging to us. You know, we have this cooking smell that happens when we cook with a lot of onions, but she also has this cleaning to clean with bleach. And so that those fragrances are in the air. Well, when we come home, you can smell that on our clothing. And here's what happens when we abide with God. When you are sitting in the Father's presence, when you're worshiping Him, when you're just singing songs and praising Him, when you're just kind of, you know, under your breath at work talking about, God, help me get this project done. You know I need you because I feel overwhelmed right now. All of those types of things, activities, they cause us to abide. And the scent, the fragrance of the Lord clings to us. And He permeates us. And it goes out into the world. That is what abiding looks like in the Spirit. And that's the scent of the Father on us. So when we sit at the Father's feet, we're close, we're intimate. We know who He is, and He knows us intimately and perfectly. That's what it means to abide. Now that we know what it means to abide, here's also what happens. And this is what happens with the enemy. So you know abiding has to do with geography. It literally has to do with location. It has to do with a spiritual location. You are in your Father's house. You are in your Father's presence. You are hanging out at the right hand of Jesus, our Savior. That's what it means to abide. But it also is a weapon for us. Psalm 91 says, "Whoever dwells in the shelter of the Most High will rest in the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, He is my refuge and my fortress, my God in whom I trust." Did you hear that? When you're abiding with God, you are in a fortress. You are in a strong, strong tower that is protecting you from the enemy, from the devil, from the things that are trying to come and kill you, steal from you, and destroy you. That's what happens when you abide. Let me just try to make this as clear as possible with a picture. So when I was young, I grew up in a neighborhood. It had a lot of drug dealers and crack, and it, you know, it just had a certain feel to the neighborhood. And in the neighborhood I grew up with, we did a lot of fighting. So let me just be real. If you're wondering, have I ever been in a fight? Multiple fights, because I mean, that's just how it was when I was growing up in my neighborhood. And the woman you see today is not the woman you known back then, because the woman you see today, I'm gonna try to pray first. I'm gonna try to hold on to the Lord. But back then, the girl that I used to be, she wasn't as nice and she wasn't as patient. And she would fight first and listen later. And then she might repent and apologize and then pray for you after she beat you up. That was who I was back then. So God has done a real work of salvation in me. But I remember there was one girl, and she was a street fighter. I mean, this girl could lay it down, and she terrified me. And I remember she was waiting for me after school one time, and y'all, my heart was pounding out of my chest. And I was chubby, and I could not run fast. I took the long way home, and it was hot. I just remember it being really, really hot. I took the long way home just to avoid her. And then as I was getting closer to my home, I could hear her with a group of girls because she knew where I lived, and she was coming close to my neighborhood. So I went through the bushes and hopped to the next street over to try to get to my house. And when I tell you, this chubby girl ran, I ran for dear life. I ran like the hounds of hell were chasing me, because they were, because I did not want to get beat up that day. Well, that's what happens with the Father. Let's try to make this scriptural, but it is true, because here's the realness of abiding in God. That tower is your safe space. When the enemy is coming after you, you can flee into the Father's presence. You can run into the Father's presence, and your daddy is so big and so bad that Satan will not cross a barrier. He will not walk into the camp of God without permission. He has no authority there, and he knows that he is subjected to Jesus Christ, okay? The sword is there, and it's there to protect you. When you cross into that space, God stands guard and says, "Don't come a step closer to my child." That's what happens when we abide in the Lord. We come under the authority and the protection of Jesus Christ. Now, can you be tempted, or can you fall into places where you shouldn't be? Of course. That's why we have to keep running into the Father's presence. Do we also go through trials that the Lord allows? Yes, we do. So can we say, "God, this is some magical thing I'm gonna do, and I'm never gonna face a trial or never be tempted"? No, because if you read the Word of God, if you abide in the Word of God, God allows certain things to happen in our lives. The truth is, we often allow more things than God is allowing, and you don't want to do that. So make sure that you spend time in God's Word, in His presence. It's your safe space to abide. It's your place to recuperate and find your breath again, so that you can stand up and fight against this enemy. That's true abiding. James 4 tells us, "Submit yourselves therefore to God. Resist the devil and he will flee from you. Draw near to God and he will draw near to you." Abiding has to do with your closeness and your proximity to the Father. Abiding means that when you get to a certain place of being near Jesus, the enemy flees, because he doesn't want anything to do with that. He doesn't want to be near Jesus whatsoever. So when you run into the presence of God, when you run into his space, when you run into that place of prayer and say, "Father, save me. Father, show me what to do. Father, your word says," when you do all of those things, the enemy flees, because he has to. He's commanded to, and you have the authority of Scripture, and you must understand your authority and your power in that place. You can cause the enemy to flee just by being close to Jesus. So when I say all of this, what does that look like in practical terms? Well, in all honesty, it really just looks like you making sure you're reading the Word of God, that you're praying the Word of God. And especially when your thoughts feel kind of crazy and out of control, and sometimes you think they're your thoughts, but they're so dark and heavy that you're not even sure, those are the times where you have to fight the hardest. You run into the Father's presence and you say, "God, this, my thought is telling me that I'm worthless. My thought is telling me that I'm no good. But your word says I am loved and I am redeemed and I am a child of God." You find those scriptures to fight with and you keep them inside of you. That's what abiding really means. The last thing I want to share with you in this video is that when we're abiding with God, we have a right to ask for things. We're a part of his household. We can ask the Father for what we need. It's no different than my children coming to me and saying, "Mom, I need a new pair of shoes," or, "Dad, can I have some money for lunch today?" They know they're not going to be denied those things because they have need of them. They're just simply reminding us of our responsibility towards them. That's what it means to abide in God and to have a place in his family, in his home. A lot of times, y'all, we are like guests in God's house. We show up and unannounced, and then we knock when we want to manipulate him and try to get something out of him, and then we go away. When we finally do need something from God, we go ahead and we ask him, but we're not even sure what the relationship is between us and the Father. We're not even sure if we have a right to ask. We don't even feel assured that he loves us enough to honor his word, because we just treat him like guests. We just show up willy-nilly here and there, and we don't put anything into the relationship. When you abide with the Father, you are a son or a daughter in His household. He knows you, and you get to know Him. You get to learn Him, and then you have an intimacy with Him. You know, you're like, just like my children. We're just like my children before the Father. When we ask for certain things, we're not asking with this uncertainty that He may not give it to us. We're actually asking on the authority of that relationship, on the closeness and the friendship and the quality of that relationship. The strength of that relationship guarantees us that there are certain things that the Father has already promised to give us. We're just going to pick up basically what He's already provided for us. We're just putting our hand out and saying, Dad, I know that you already have lunch money prepared for me, so can you go ahead and put it in my hand? That's what it looks like in the Spirit when we're abiding with the Father. So we get to ask for what we need with authority, but we've got to stop being strangers in the household of God. So what does it have to do with you and your body and food freedom? It has everything to do with it, because you're so often we're struggling and we're saying, God, can you set me free? But we don't even know who we're asking or what we're really asking for. Take some time to know the rights that you have in His household, in His kingdom. He's already promised us freedom. We get to go ahead and ask Him for that freedom. But what we don't do is listen to the steps that He's giving us to get the freedom we need. We want to go in and ask, take, snatch the money and run. But God has things that He needs us to do. He's not going to just give us the money. He's not going to be pimped out so that He just hands us money when we want it and then we run out the door. That's not how that works. Real freedom requires obedience. It requires relationship. It requires being present with the Father. He wants us at His feet. He wants us near Him. He's saying, your freedom comes when you're close to me. Your freedom comes when you know what I've said. Your freedom comes when you know your authority in Jesus, my Son, that I gave to you as your Savior. So when the enemy is coming, now you know, because I'm close to the Father, I hear Him saying that this is not my thought, that this is a thought from the enemy. And then God will tell you what to say back to the devil. God may have you turn around and say, flee from me, Satan. Therefore, there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. It's okay that you say those things out loud when you need to. It's okay that you think those things when those thoughts are coming into your head. You can tell the devil, you have no authority here. Get out of my mind and get out of my life, because the word of God said, for there is no condemnation for those who are found in Christ Jesus. You wield that word and you say it out loud. I used to let all kinds of thoughts come into my head, and I wouldn't take captive those thoughts like scripture told us, because I thought they were mine. It took me years to realize it was the enemy attacking me, attacking my thought life. Even when I would have these random thoughts, or even when I would have these thoughts when I was in an argument with my husband and I felt angry, I thought those were my thoughts. Instead of stopping and saying the word of God, I would just say whatever popped into my head. Those were not my thoughts, but they became my thoughts when I took them. They became my thoughts when I took them. What would it look like if every time a thought popped in our head, like we've just eaten, we know physically we're not hungry, but what if instead of that thought, ooh, don't you want some ice cream? Instead of that thought taking root in our minds, we say, Father, I feel tempted right now. You promised that if I draw near to you, that the devil would flee. So my mind is telling me I'm hungry, but I'm gonna run into your presence. And Father, I'm gonna worship you. And then you just pray, Heavenly Father, I thank you that you're a very present help in time of need. I'm in need of you right now. That's scripture, by the way. I thank you that you're a very present help. And I thank you that this feeling of hunger, if it's not real, Father, I pray that you would cast it out in the name of Jesus. I welcome your filling. I welcome your nourishment. For Jesus, you are the bread of life. What if we fought like that? What if every time those random thoughts to go eat, or every time we were standing in the middle of the kitchen making a plate of food larger than the size of our bodies, and we feel like we're gonna eat this supersized meal, what if we put the plate down and just dropped it and said out loud, I will not be drawn into this temptation, for the Lord my God is a very present help in time of need. What if we spoke scripture in that moment and then we ran from the room and we ran into our bedrooms and grabbed our Bibles real quick and put the Bible app in our ears so we could hear the scripture in our minds and we left the food? What would it look like? What if you did that every time you felt tempted? Where would you be 1 year from now? Where would your life be? It's incredible what the Word of God can do for us. That's the very same strategy He gave me. That's what it looked like. I didn't try to white knuckle it with a diet plan. I didn't pay hundreds and thousands of dollars for some pills or something that could, that over the counter that I thought could make me better. I ran to the source and I said, God, I'm struggling with this. Teach me how to fight in the Spirit. Teach me to abide so that I can rise up in strength. That's what He did for me, and that's what He can do for you. So before we go, I want to share with you two things. I want to share with you our memory verse, and I want to share with you a quick story. Our memory verse this week is James chapter 4, and you heard me mention it earlier. It says, submit yourselves therefore to God, resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Draw near to God, and he will draw near to you. Drawing near to God and just being in his presence, it's all about abiding. It's about intimacy and just being close to the Father. So immersed in him that you start to smell like his household, that his scent is carried before you. And that very scent, well, it is the scent of life for many of us, but it is the stench of death. So that's gonna make the enemy very angry. And that's okay, because you have a strong tower that you can run into and be safe. God has equipped you and he has provided for you and he is your shield of protection. So let him protect you. You know, this week on my YouTube channel, I posted a picture and I shared the book that I wrote, God's Perfect Size. And above it, I wrote, this has been a 10-year long journey. And it's actually been over 10 years. I think it's more like 11 and a half. When I first started this teaching, it's always just been available. I've been trying to teach it for years, but I quit for a really long time. And I want to tell you why I quit. All those years ago when I first wrote God's Perfect Size, so much stuff happened to me when I started teaching this book. I started teaching it in a small group at a church that I belong to in North Carolina. And my passion was to see as many people set free as possible. Because y'all, when I was looking out at the scape of humanity, I noticed that a lot of people of faith in our churches were overweight. They were struggling in their health and they were struggling with all of the weight related diseases that come. And that broke my heart, because I think it broke my heart because I kept praying for God to give me a heart for his people. And because it was my particular struggle, it was like, it was all I could see. I noticed it everywhere I went. And I would go down the grocery aisle and see people and pray for them if I saw they were struggling with food addiction or they were extremely overweight or obese. I would pray wherever I went. But I noticed it was a particular plague in the house of God. And I wondered why for so long. And I realized the enemy uses food because it seems so benign to the people of God. It feels like such a benign weapon that we don't even fight it like it's a spiritual battle. We just go on a diet. And it's like everything we know about fighting in the spirit, we throw out the window when it comes to food addiction. But it can't be that way. It cannot be that way. We are the children of God. We have a job to do. And the reason God has sent me on this path is because he wants us to wake up. He wants to take his kingdom back. He wants us to walk in authority and power. We have to live out our gifts, but we can't do what the Father's calling us to do if we are sick and overweight and addicted to food and we cut our life short. The work that you're supposed to do in 20 years, guess what? You may not be here in 20 years, because we're allowing this to keep us trapped and stuck in addictions. So we've got to fight back. We have got to fight back. So I started to tell you a story a few years ago when I first wrote this book, y'all. I was all gung-ho. I mean, I was green around the gills and I was like, I'm gonna write this book and I'm gonna share it with as many people as possible and they're gonna find their freedom in Christ and they're gonna walk in the wholeness of it. But I had limited knowledge about what it meant to abide in the Word of God and the power that comes from abiding. See, when I first wrote this book, I knew scripture, so I started using scripture, and I would pray, and I would fast, and I would do all of these things. But when the enemy showed up, he He was kicking my tail all over the place. I'm going to share a passage with you. And even when I went back to find this passage, there were some things that I had forgotten. I'm going to read this little bit to you, and it's going to be quick. But I said, one morning I woke up and couldn't get out of bed. My back was in so much pain I could barely move. I became bedridden and unable to lift anything, including my children. So I ran off to the chiropractor. You know, they did a couple x-rays. They found some degeneration in my back, and they thought that was the source of it. And then the week prior to that, I got ringworm. And then the week after that, my hair... During that whole time, my hair started falling out. And then after that, I got the stomach flu. And then two days after the stomach flu, my elbow swelled up the size of Texas. I mean, it was just one physical ailment after the other. And then, right around that time, my son got hurt severely. And all of this was happening within the span of a month, within just a few weeks. And you know what happened? Because I didn't know the Word of God well back then, I just let it happen. I didn't know that I had the authority that I have today. I didn't even know the Father would fight for me back then. I was praying, God, heal me, but I wasn't praying, God, the enemy's attacking me. I need you to stop him. I need to bind this thing in the name of Jesus. I need to loose this in the name of Jesus. I didn't know any of that. I just kept letting these things happen, and then I would pray after the fact. Y'all, had I been really abiding back then and understanding my authority and position in Jesus Christ, I could have stopped a lot of what was happening. So I'm here to tell you, when all of these things start coming against you, run into the Father's presence, abide in him, and don't take it lightly. Don't just sit back and let the enemy do whatever he wants to you. Go ahead and whip out those scriptures. When you see something happening with your children, I need you to pray protection over them and pray, because the same God that I read to you about in Psalm 91, him being a strong tower, pray that tower would surround your children and protect them. Pray the same God who's the deliverer would deliver you from the enemy of temptation. You have authority. Pray over these things and let God rescue you while you just sit immersed in his presence. That is true abiding. It is a weapon against the enemy, but it is a safe space for you. So abide. I pray this message blesses you, and I pray that you hear exactly what you need to hear this week so that you can fight back. Keep fighting for your freedom. Keep pressing in and don't give up, because the Father has not given up. The process may take longer than you ever thought possible. That's okay. Let God do a thorough work so that when you come out, you are utterly and absolutely free in Jesus' name. I want as many people as possible to be reached. So I'm going to just share with you quickly. If you're looking for God's Perfect Size by Kim Jogway, it's on Amazon. If you look, and the workbook will accompany it. I think it's best if you do it in a friendship or a partnership, so you have an accountability partner and you can pray together and you know exactly what the plan is together, and you can check in with each other and lift each other up. So if you are in need of something to help you fight, and also a place where all of these scriptures are housed, check out the book. It's on Amazon. It's called God's Perfect Size Revised. Get it. Use it. Let me know what you think, and I'll be praying for you. Until the next video, I look forward to seeing you in video 6. I pray God's grace would keep you and protect you. Bye.